Daddy, who lived out in the country on the Cherrystone River, used to have me as a visitor summers. They had a ferry ran twice a day. And if you wanted to go into town, you had to wait for hours for that ferry. One year, they built a bridge and washed out the next year. But for a little while, I knew what it felt like to go where I wanted to go, when I wanted to go.
Keep the change.
How'd you get that lady a change?
I just want to give you a taste of the Chicago life. I mean, people say keep the change all the time. Sure. Hey, you want a soda?
From where?
Over there.
Because you must be 2 cents short of a nickel if you think them white folks gonna let us sit up there and drink a pop.
You scared, Lou Jean?
I ain't crazy.
All right. And stay, Uncle. I'm gonna have me a soda pop. This town's still in America.
Children, what are you doing?
2 soda pops, please.
Sir. Oh.
Your money is no good here, nigger.
Don't it spend just like everybody else?
Listen to him, children. You know you ain't doing right.
There's some people in here who'd get a righteous tickle out of seeing y'all locked up in a ratty jail cell just to fill a quota.
That's right.
Now, you better strike like the wind and get the hell out of here before you start something you can't finish.
Au-dessus des étangs, au-dessus des vents, des montagnes, des bois, des nuages, des mers. Mon esprit, sous ces mers avec agilité. Et comme un bon mesure, que ces palmes en l'ombre, avec indicible et ma velouté.
Wonderful pronunciation, Diane. People, how sad, isn't it? To compare Baudelaire's depiction of existence on a higher plane with the decadence of the life he actually led.
Oh, I don't think it's sad at all. Baudelaire lived that way on purpose, as a way of attaining poetic vision. I mean, in this poem, he talks about reaching the mystery of all things, but not by thinking about it. That's blind. It's through the sensual.
Y'all get in the car. What's the charge?
Where you from, boy?
Chicago.
I'm gonna send you back in a box.
I'll never do it right.
It's easy. Just run all the way.
How'd you learn it, Roddy?
Kirk Douglas did in the Vikings. I saw it 4 times.
What in God's name do you think you're doing?
It's mine. Give it back.
John Morgan, you live in this house. This is a parlor. People sit here. This is not a barn.
Moo!
You could have put an eye out. And who's gonna fix that?
You are.
Oh, is that a fact?
You're the maid, aren't you?
You boys, go outside. Now. Get now.
Give me back my knife.
I'll take mighty good care of it. Don't you worry.
I'll take mighty good care of it. Don't you worry.
Do it again, Roddy. I'll take my can of it. Don't you worry.
Lynn Hollander. Man, I'd whistle through her wheat field any day of the week. She's going to Ross Butler's party with Mickelson.
So you're taking Cookie Baker, right?
Yeah, I'm meeting her there. That way, if it doesn't work out, I won't have to drive her home.
You know who I think's really fine?
Who?
Diane Love.
Yeah, she's all right, except she's kind of stuck up. Maybe she's just private. Why don't you ask her to the party?
No. She's got a boyfriend in military school.
I knew you didn't have the grit.
Say, Paul.
If you'd like to go tonight.
Thanks, but I don't think so. Mister, you know who must be coming home for the weekend?
No, it's just that seeing Ralph Butler vomit on his high five is not my idea of a must attend.
Well, it doesn't have to be Butler's. We can just go out.
Okay.
We were hoping that you could somehow see fit to lower bail from $100. The boy had to go to the hospital. Hasn't he suffered enough?
His suffering truly saddens me. I'm sorry, but there's little I can do about the bail.
Was there little you could do last month when white teenagers were accused of breaking windows on Main Street and their bail was set at $10?
They did not break laws regarding segregated eating places, Reverend.
So if Lou Jean Lomax and Billy Joe Kelly had engaged in vandalism, their bail, too, would only be $10.
Yes?
Still, I don't think I will encourage black youngsters to bust windows the next time, even though they'd be better off.
Reverend, we've had dealings before. You're a shrewd man. The disparity in those bail amounts shows you the faith and importance the community you live in places in the philosophy of separate but equal.
I must admit, Mr. Bedford, I had expected some sensitivity on your part to the issue before us. Since the arrest of white men and the death of Prentice Carver, the sentiment in the Negro community has been to expect some sense of fair play from your office.
You seem to have a fundamental misunderstanding of me. Dwight Tully murdered a man. When I prosecuted him, I was simply doing my job.
Back in Chicago, my nephew has a chance to enter college.
I'm sorry.
That's the final word from the district attorney's office.
I hope we understand each other. What's this?
Check made out for $200 to cover the bail for the two youngsters.
You're paying this yourself?
From the legal department of the NAACP. And that stands for...
I know what it stands for, Reverend.
Thanks for the movie.
Who are you thanking me for? You asked me out. It was your idea, remember?
To a movie, yes. La Dolce Vita, no.
Did you really enjoy it?
Yeah, I really did. Even the subtitles. No, I mean it. It's reassuring to know that I can both watch and read at the same time.
I had a good time tonight, Nathan.
Where are you from?
New Orleans.
That explains French class.
My parents sent me to Paris last summer to study. That's what I want to major in when I go to college. What about you?
I haven't thought about it, really.
freezing out here on the porch. Hello?
Mom, Deb, Nathan, my parents.
Happy to meet you, Nathan. Please come in.
No, I think I should be going. Oh,
come on, I'll make us all some hot cocoa before I send you out in the blizzard.
I've asked you all into my home tonight, not in the interest of official church business, yet what I'm going to ask of you is in the name of God. You all aware, no doubt, of the arrest of two of our youths as they attempted to order sodas from the Pickmore department store lunch counter. Well, the time has come for us to step down off the sidewalk and meet the full force of discrimination and injustice head on.
But barely 50% of the chapter voted to mobilize, Reverend.
True, Brother Jonah, but I'm not talking about the entire congregation. I'm talking about us four men.
What sort of response did you have in mind?
A return to the Pickmore department store lunch counter and ordering us four glasses of soda.
I don't think so.
Why is that, Brother Prince?
I just don't feel that the time is right.
Then when will it be?
You know, one of those kids wasn't even one of us. He's from up north. Just thought he'd be the big man, is all.
Well, I know that your business dealings with the white community are substantial. I must remind you that the vast majority of Negroes living in Breland suffer hourly under the strain of segregation.
When my daddy was my age, he picked cotton for a man named Mr. Wiley Phillips. Every God-sent harvest morning, he went down to the field and picked that man's cotton till his knees were raw, his hands swollen, back burnt by the sun. One day, old Wiley went screaming down to the field, waving his shiny 44. Some butterhead Negro said, my father stole Mr. Wiley's pickle. His pickle. Not his money. Not his pride. Not his wife. His pickle. Shot my daddy dead. Bam. Guilty as charged. Like that. Bam.
You stay home tomorrow, Brother Alphonse.
I will not.
Your anger against the white man is a liability.
It won't be, Reverend. It won't.
No longer can we allow our women and children to do the work of men, which is what we are. Men. We're not two-fifths, we're not three-fifths, we're not four-fifths men, but we're men. Freedom. Oh, freedom. Oh, freedom. Over me and before I be a slave, I'll be buried in my
I'm sorry if I called too late.
No, it's fine. It's nice.
Can I see you tomorrow?
Okay.
When?
I don't care, whenever you want.
Tomorrow night?
Okay.
We'll do something.
I don't know.
Something.
Diane, I'll call you tomorrow.
Sleep well, Nathan.
John Morgan.
Good morning, Lilly.
Not from where I'm standing. Did you get into this ice cream last night?
No.
No? Then who did?
Nathan.
No, it wasn't Nathan. Nathan doesn't eat ice cream on account of his wrestling.
Then it was either a Francie or a burglar.
John Morgan, did you do this?
No, I came in here last night and I saw the ice cream. I thought whoever was eating it had maybe gone to the bathroom and wasn't finished, so I just left it. But I didn't touch nothing.
John Morgan, what's come over you lately? It's not like you to lie.
I'm not lying. Stop picking on me. Stop picking on me or I'll tell my daddy on you.
So, what'd you do last night?
Oh, I went to a movie.
Oh, yeah? Did you get anything? No. What's the matter? She's pretty built. Didn't you try?
No. I mean, I kissed her at her doorway. Then her parents came home.
Joanne Doris was asking about you at the party last night. I told her and Creel Davidson that we'd meet up with him later at the diner.
I can't.
Oh. Why not?
Because I'm going out with Diane.
What is this, man?
What?
Two nights in a row? What's going on?
Nothing.
I don't get it. It used to be just you and me, the gruesome twosome. Love him and leave him. This girl's not for you.
Why not?
I don't know. She's born, stuck up.
No, she's not.
Yeah? Well, I say she is. I mean, even her name, Diane Lowe, it's boring.
It's really Lowenstein.
Lowenstein?
Yeah, they changed it when her grandfather or somebody first came over here from Europe.
Yeah, you want to know why they changed it? Because they're a bunch of Jews, that's why.
What are you talking about?
Did you just fall off the turnip truck, Bedford? Lowenstein is a Jewish name. Diane Lowenstein is a Jew. You going out with Kikes now, are you?
Hell no.
I didn't think so. I'll see you later.
Come on. Lily!
chance to calm down.
Let me go!
They were spying on me from my closet.
What are you so ashamed of?
You little rat.
Sam Morgan, get in your room. Roddy, you go home.
You can't make me.
Little boy, if you don't get out of this house in 1 minute, I'm going to put a blazer on your backside so hot you won't be able to sit down till next Christmas. Now go home.
Dora's leaving anyway.
You little bucket brat.
John Morgan, get to your room.
Three glasses of soda, please.
I don't know what you niggers are trying to prove, but if I were you, I'd get on with you right now.
Ever had the feel of a noose around your neck, Smokey?
Hanging niggers is out of style. We burn them these days. And let me tell you, there ain't no prettier smell than the stench of niggers burning. Well, boy, I didn't know y'all was that thirsty.
This one looks like a coffee drinking boy to me.
A soda, if you please.
What's going on out here? Y'all better get up from there and go on home. You're a disgrace to the race. Go on home. Reverend.
It's no use.
Oh,
right.
Found one to go with.
Shame on you.
Come back.
He won't be back.
I'm both surprised and disappointed by what you've done.
Your disappointment does little to change the circumstances before us.
Which are?
I sit here before you incarcerated for having the audacity to order a glass of soda from a public lunch counter.
Your actions caused a near riot in that store.
If white hatred is your problem, why have I been afforded these accommodations?
The problem, Reverend Henry, is that you broke the law.
I ask you, Mr. Bedford, is that law valid under the Constitution of the United States?
I am mandated to carry out the community standards of the state and community where we live.
As the leading law officer of the county, shouldn't it be your place to right a fundamental wrong?
You made your point. They ever set it $100.
I'm afraid not.
What?
I refuse the offer. I will remain in jail until my hearing.
Bedford home?
No, ma'am, it's not.
I assume you're Lilly.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm Mrs. Anderson, Roddy's mother.
Yes, ma'am.
May I come in, or is it customary for you to keep people standing out in the cold? Let me just start by saying that Belle May Turner has worked for my family since I was 4 days old. though it was not always the model child, Lord knows she never raised her voice or threatened to take a switch to me, no matter what I had done. I would like my son's hunting knife. Who do you think you are, speaking to my son in that manner? I have a good mind to send my husband over here and straighten you out. Do you understand?
Yes, I understand.
You are a nothing and a nobody, and you had better never forget it.
Hope you're not thinking about jumping. I was in town shopping and I saw your car out front. I'd have to drop by on a weekend more often.
I'm very glad you did.
What are you thinking about?
I've been standing here looking out on our town.
My town. My children's town. Your town.
Walking through the square this morning, I swear I could feel the tension around me. Everybody's moving so carefully. It's like they're all waiting for something to break. I guess I feel that way, too.
Dave Farley of the Chamber of Commerce came by to see me the other night to applaud on behalf of the good people of Breland. My stern handling of those two Negro teenagers the other day.
Well, I guess things are looking up, aren't they?
I felt I was being welcomed back into the family again.
You alienated a lot of people during the trial. White lawyers are not supposed to prosecute white men on behalf of
I was simply doing my job, just as I was simply doing my job with those Negro teenagers, and now with Reverend Henry.
It's tough to be an outsider, especially in your own hometown. Somewhat the way the coloreds feel, do you think?
I think there are two towns here, and had been for a long time before I ever came around. I prosecute under the laws and statutes of this state. And no harder or softer because of anyone's race. Or to impress any one race.
Okay. I admire you very much. And I love you very much, too.
Where is everybody?
Nathan's getting ready for a date. Francis's up in her room. And John Morgan's upstairs, sitting on his pajamas.
Miss Bedford. Miss Anderson came by this afternoon. She's the mother of one of John Morgan's friends. She gave me a dressing down.
Why did she do that?
Because I sent her boy home earlier today. I don't think he's a good influence on John Morgan.
What makes you say that?
John Morgan has begun to give me a lot of back talk. And earlier this afternoon, he and Roddy were hiding in Frances's closet, spying on her when she came in from her shower. Now, I'm not trying to say what they did was awful terrible in and of itself, but I don't have a good feeling about Roddy.
The other day, they were throwing around a huge knife.
What are you asking me to do, Lily? You want me to forbid John Morgan from seeing Roddy?
No, sir. But you have given me the responsibility of looking after your children 15 hours a day, 6 days a week. Along with that responsibility, I would like to have the authority that should go with it.
John Morgan.
You're supposed to have your pajamas on by now.
I was just going.
John Morgan, Lily and I want to talk to you.
About what?
Well, first of all, it's not okay for you to throw knives or to play with knives. Boy I knew when I was little was killed accidentally, just that way.
He was?
Now, John Morgan, when I'm not at home, Lily is in charge here.
But she's not my mommy.
No. No, she's not. But she is the boss when I'm not here. She's in charge. When she tells you something, I expect you to do it without a lot of back talk and sass.
What if she's wrong?
That will be decided by me when I get home at night. But until I do, what she says goes. Do you understand?
Yes, Daddy.
Good. Now, you get ready for bed, and I'll come back upstairs in a few minutes.
You're a tattletale.
Did you hear what your daddy just said?
You're not my mom. You can't tell me what to do, because you're a nobody.
Try startling about Diane Lowe, huh?
What? Oh. Who told you that?
Paul Slocum asked her about it yesterday during assembly. He was kind of kidding about it. He said you told him. He said you'd never go out with somebody who wears a beanie.
Something good, I hope.
Now, Lily, you and I have had our differences lately. I was thinking that when we raised the money for the church kitchen, I can't think of anyone more suited to run it than you.
I want to talk to you about Reverend Henry.
Now, you don't really expect our church to get involved in that.
Well, it was my idea that if other churches supported him, it would mean a lot.
That preacher is a public disgrace. He reaped what he sowed.
Reverend, I don't want to argue with you about these things all the time, but it makes me mad that the Pickmore will take my money for hair ribbons and mixing bowls, but it will not serve me food. Now, I know this makes you mad. It must.
So you are going to argue with me?
I think we should demonstrate for Reverend Henry until he gets out of jail.
Lily, a man of God does not belong in the habitat of thieves.
Jesus spent time there.
Don't argue scripture with me, child. I'm fed up with it.
Reverend James.
I won't be able to... to come here anymore to worship.
Where the hell do you get off telling Diane Lowe that I won't go out with her again?
What's your problem?
She stayed home today. Do you know that? She didn't come to school. What is it? Rosh Moshe or something? Lenny Hollander said that she was crying after assembly. Let me get something straight here. Are you trying to tell me that you want to keep going out with this Abe? Stay out of our business. Our business? Man, she has got you PW'd. You don't even want to hang out anymore. You heard me. Stay away from Diane. Okay, Bedford. I knows how you feel. I knows how you feel. Hi, Miss Lowe. Is Diane home?
Well, yes, she is, but she's not feeling well.
Well, there she is.
Oh, Diane? It's Nathan.
Can I talk to you for a few minutes?
You missed school, and you're going out there that day? Mom.
I'm sorry.
What are you doing here?
Apologizing? Look, I really am. I've been messed up all day. Not seeing you. Knowing that you're ticked off. I did say that I wouldn't go out. But I was just joking, talking. It's 180 degrees from the way I really feel.
So Paul Slocum manages your affairs? He's your social secretary?
No. Look, I did say hell no. I was just talking. Sort of a joke.
What's so funny about it?
Nothing.
Why would you do that?
I don't know. People just say stuff.
Oh, you didn't mean it at all.
Look, I'm really sorry.
Mad at me?
Well, John Morgan, I guess I am, yes.
I'm sorry, Lilly.
I can see that. But saying you're sorry one time or 1,000 times doesn't necessarily make everything better.
I can't stand having you be mad at me. It makes me feel sick, like I might throw up. I didn't mean what I said.
John Morgan. Why do you want to be friends with a boy like Roddy?
Because we have fun.
Ever notice that whenever Roddy's having fun, someone else is not having fun?
Yes, will you forgive me now?
We haven't finished talking about what we're talking about.
Roddy's not a fair person, but nobody does the stuff Roddy will do.
But if something went wrong, I wonder if Roddy would stick by you. I guess you have to decide whether you want a friend like Roddy or friends who will always be by your side no matter what.
You like that about me?
Yes, I am. And your sister is, too. And neither of us need for you to write, "I'm sorry," 1,000 times to forgive you.
I know.
Do you? Let me ask you, if Roddy were mad at you, would 1,000 times be enough?
I brought some food, but they don't let the prisoners have that.
Well, thank you very much, just the same, Miss...
Lily Harper. We met once. You spoke at the funeral for Marcus Williams. Drowned in that bus.
I'm sorry.
Okay. Reverend, I'm leaving my old church. I want to join yours.
Where were you worshiping?
Aikensville First Baptist.
Well, of course you're welcome to join our congregation.
There's something else, Reverend.
Well, unburden yourself, Sister Harper. You seem all tensed up.
Actually, I don't feel that way at all. I feel very free talking to you like this. I respect you very much, Reverend. I want to join your movement.
It's your movement. Welcome to it. Lord, you have before you two of your children struggling towards the light, struggling to emulate your love and patience. Walk with us, Lord, as we travel in these many days to come. Be with us, Lord, as we walk through Canaan land. Give us the strength, Lord. Give us the courage, Lord. For they cannot be free unless we are free, Lord.
When I was little and my daddy had his Hudson, we'd drive home from relatives at night and I'd look at the houses going by and wonder, who lives in there? What's their life like? What are they doing right now? Many of these were white people's houses, and as I grew up, I came to know the answers to those questions because I went to work in those houses. Sometimes at night, I realize, though, that white people, even to this day, still don't know what goes on in my house. They've never been in my house. When they have been there, that'll be the time Reverend Henry talks about.
On the next, I'll Fly Away.
Your money's good enough to fill up their cash registers. Not good enough to get you a stool at their lunch counter.
Why are you doing this to me?
I could ask you why you're doing this. Pursuing the most backward-thinking line with a vengeance.
We ain't never had problems like this before. We coloreds want things different.
It's time to stop acting invisible.
With us for The Way Things Are when I'll Fly Away returns next Friday night at 8. Frank Sinatra's songs have underscored American life for nearly half a century, capturing the essence of that time. In a few moments, we'll trace his rise to stardom from his earliest days through the mid-60s. Frank Sinatra, the voice of our time, is next here on 11.